and consent to a reformation of the national church on Presbyterian lines. But Baxter now encountered in the new model army a body of men among whom the radical ideas of the religious independence had taken root.
These tough, Bible-quoting, disputatious soldiers were agreed on two things: that the state had no right to interfere in the church, and that Charles was a tyrant and a traitor who must be defeated and brought to account for his crime. For the Presbyterian Baxter, who believed in a God-ordained order and discipline, this was a nightmarish vision of unchristian anarchy. But it was also a vision, Baxter realized, that the men of the new model were determined to turn into a reality.
Thanks to the strength of the new model army, what was there to stop them? On the 7th of June, 1647, Charles I met his nemesis, Oliver Cromwell, for the first time, when Cromwell and the other army leaders came to offer the king a deal. Following his defeat in the Civil War, Charles was now Parliament's prisoner, but he found himself in an unexpectedly favourable position, for the divisions among his enemies were becoming wider by the day. The Presbyterians in Parliament, like their allies, the Scottish Covenanters, wanted to impose their form of religion on the whole nation, whereas the Independents in the army wanted an end to religious prescription and the toleration of all forms of worship, so long as they were Protestant. Both sides knew that to swing things their way, they needed the political legitimacy which only God's anointed sovereign could command. Hence the deal offered by the army. It was a triangular game in which the king seemed to hold the strongest hand.
But Charles characteristically overplayed it, rejecting the astonishingly lenient political terms he was offered by Cromwell and the other army leaders in order to guarantee religious toleration. Instead, in a cynical renversement d'alliance, the king joined forces with his original enemies, the Scots Covenanters, in return for the king's promise, which he'd no intention whatever of keeping, to impose Presbyterianism throughout the British Isles. The Scots invaded England to restore King Charles I and to wipe out the new model army with its damnable belief in religious toleration.
But in August 1648, the Second Civil War, as it became known, came to a bloody end in a three-day battle at Preston. This was Cromwell's first engagement in sole command of the new model army, and he showed his tactical genius by manoeuvring to cut off the Scots' retreat, thus turning a defeat into an annihilating rout. "Take courage," Cromwell wrote to Parliament after the battle, "to do the work of the Lord." In fact, terrified by the army and its radical religious views, Parliament was seeking to make a peace with Charles, which sold the pass on all the main issues of the war. Double-crossed by both King and Parliament, the army's Council of Officers now decided to strike down both. On the 1st of December, the army seized the King. On the 6th, Colonel Pride entered the House of Commons and purged it of the 150-strong Presbyterian majority. The Rump, as it was now known, of 50 independents, now proclaimed itself the supreme power in the nation, with the authority to pass Acts of Parliament without the consent of the King or the House of Lords.
The Second Civil War and Cromwell's great victory at Preston produced a marked hardening in his attitudes, especially towards the king. Henceforward, Cromwell saw Charles, who'd engineered the war on his own initiative and for his own selfish ends, as a man of blood who must be punished for his crimes. Cromwell's view of his own role also took on a larger compass. Thinking biblically, as always, he saw himself as Gideon, the Jewish farmer summoned from the plough to lead the armies of Israel against the Midianites and to kill their king.
On the 20th of January, 1649, King Charles I was brought here to Westminster Hall to be tried for high treason.
Charles's strategy, which he stuck to with dogged persistence, was to refuse to recognise either the authority or the legality of the court. And throughout the week-long trial, both the king and his judges sat with their hats firmly on their heads in a standoff of mutual disrespect.
But with the army and the radicals in Parliament in control, the verdict was never in serious doubt.
This is the death warrant of Charles I, signed and sealed by 59 of his judges, and ordering his execution by the severing of his head from his body on the 30th of January, 1649, with its requirement that the execution should take place in the open street before Whitehall. It's a bold and brave document. But it also highlights the titanic effort of will that was needed to bring even this panel of committed parliamentarians to take the terrible, irrevocable step of publicly executing a king. Both the date of the warrant itself and the date of the execution have been inserted over erasures. Two of the names of the men who were in charge of the execution have been changed following the refusal of the original nominees. And many of the signatures we know were only obtained after long, hard lobbying. Overseeing it all, driving it all, and allegedly even guiding the pens of the reluctant signers was the third man to sign, Oliver Cromwell.
The 30th of January was bitterly cold. Charles put on two shirts, for he didn't want to be seen shivering, lest onlookers mistake it as a sign of fear.
At about noon, Charles drank a small glass of claret and ate a little bread. Then he was escorted through the banqueting house here at Whitehall, the scene of the gaudy triumphs of the Stuart court, and stepped through one of the windows onto the high, black-draped scaffold in the street below. I go from a corruptible to an incorruptible crown, the king said to his chaplain, Bishop Juxon, where no disturbance can be, no disturbance in the world. Then the king removed from his neck the garter jewel of St. George, made from a single onyx encircled with diamonds, and handed it to Juxon with the instruction that it should be given to the Prince of Wales with the one word, remember. Charles's most valuable legacy to his son proved to be the manner of his death. 60 years previously, Charles's grandmother, Mary Queen of Scots, had died flamboyantly as a passionate martyr to the Catholic faith. Charles instead, with quiet dignity, offered himself up as a sacrifice to his vision of Christian kingship.